turn it around. And there is our awesome view. Well, that works. Yeah. Okay, get on. Okay. Now I can see it. We're good. You have the hair, flag in your hair?
Yeah.
That's cute. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, sure. I just had to hit resume is all I had to do.
Cool. Here's the bouncing ball while I do my stuff, and then you take over.
Okay.
Yeah, you guys are going to have to teach me how to do that too when we have this.
God bless you guys. Thank you for joining us here at One Accord Crusades. We love to love you guys. It's what we do. We love you guys. So we're here today. We're going to pray in right now, and then we're going to get into praise and worship. So I'll pray us in real quick, or not, but it'll be a prayer. Father, we come to you in Jesus' name, and we thank you for this Memorial Day, the day where we remember those who bravely fought for this country and the freedoms that we so cherish in this country. And we thank you for them, and we thank you for their families, and we ask that you would send your spirit to comfort all the families who have lost brave men and women in the fight for freedom. So we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you that your spirit is here upon us today and upon this nation and upon this world, for your word says that you will pour out your spirit upon all flesh in the end times, which we are in. So we thank you for that, Lord. We ask that you would anoint this message and anoint the praise that we are about to sing to you with cheerful hearts, Lord. We thank you for the birds that are singing right now, praises all times. We can hear them all around. We thank you for the breeze and that it's not too hot. We thank you, Father, for so many things. We have a heart of gratitude and thankfulness for you and for what you've done for our lives and what you continue to do in us and through us. And so we ask that you would open up California again, Father, that your churches may gather, that we may gather together in unity, in one accord for you, Lord, with the purpose of loving others and bringing them into the kingdom and teaching them so that they may bring others back in, like our mission statement says. So, Father, we give this time to you. We dedicate our praise to you, our hearts to you. Use our tongues in praise. Use our bodies how you see fit, for we are bought with a price, and we are not our own. We are yours, Lord, and we belong to you, and we thank you for that high price you paid on Calvary for us. And as we approach Pentecost, Lord, let us be in one accord as the disciples were in the book of Acts, Father, that you would pour out your spirit upon your church, Father, because we need your Holy Spirit to function. We need your Holy Spirit for everything we do. We need to utterly rely upon you, Father, for your Holy Spirit. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, for you are welcome in this place. We ask that you would pour out upon the neighbors around us and all those online, and that you would ask people to tune in, Father, nudge them by your spirit to tune in to one accord, that they may hear an anointed praise and message, and that they may be inspired by you to come back to you or to even go deeper in your word and deeper in a relationship with you, Jesus. So we thank you for these things, and we give this service to you. We dedicate it all to you. It's all for you and your glory, God. May you be glorified in everything we do and say today. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Woo-hoo!
Yeah.
Wow.
So that's your water, and...
This is your clipboard.
My water is right
here. So it doesn't blow in the...
Okay. Oh, yeah, thanks. You have experience with that.
Amen.
So, woo! I can grab my mic, and then I'll take it over here.
Okay.
And I'll just hold it.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
Wow, that is so awesome. What an awesome prayer that was.
Hallelujah.
We are one accord.
Amen.
Amen. And we invite you to sing along with us. Amen. We're going to start off with joy in the Lord, because there is joy in the Lord. Today is an awesome day. Tomorrow is our Memorial Day. And there's joy in a lot of people's hearts. I saw where the on Fox Nation, where there were some veterans on there, and they said they don't want sadness, they want rejoicing.
Amen.
Because they fought for the freedom.
Yes.
And they loved doing that.
1. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
24:1.
Oh, 24:1.
But that's good.
That's a good one.
Amen.
Well, I know 24.
You're not going to fear.
And the wind kicked up again. Right?
Ah. Oh, prophetic. The Psalm 24:1. Well, this is. I was wondering why we were on 27, because 24 is one of our three P's. Psalm 24 and Proverbs 24, which are both awesome. You need to read them if you haven't today. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof.
Amen.
The world and they that dwell therein. Amen.
Amen. The next psalms are all going to come from Psalms 24. Amen.
Awesome.
Last week, and there's Who is the King of Glory? That's a theme of this chapter, but we did that song last week. So we're going to do More Than Enough. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to bless the Lord with that.
Amen.
Give your song, God. Woo! Woo!
He is my help, Shaddai. He always looks out for me.
He is my help, Shaddai.
He is my help, Shaddai. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks, who seeks your face. Oh God, a Jacob. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks, who seeks your face. Oh God. Bend our knees, oh Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our lives from evil things, oh Lord, we cast down our idols. So give us clean hands and give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh, give us clean hands and give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh, God, let us be a generation that seeks, who seeks your face. Oh, God, a change.
Today we have the plan that we're going to go over, and
Can you do the bouncing ball?
I will. Yes, let me get a copy, and I will do the bouncing
ball.
It's
on the clipboard.
Oh.
Amen.
Okay. All right. So, get situated, and I will do the bouncing ball.
Amen. Amen. We have a skeleton crew today. A lot of people go off for Memorial Day weekend, and they're enjoying themselves. And we do have a guest, Mama Trusky, sitting in the shade over there. Hello. And we have you on Facebook as guest. Awesome. We're going to go over the plan for May 2020. We always go over this every week because sometimes we forget on what the mission vision is and the mission. And we want to remind everybody it's about Jesus and then to have a personal relationship with him. So our vision is the Jesus model. And where did Jesus preach? He went to the outside to the crowds, and he spent time in study and prayer with close friends. Not only close friends, but anybody who had an ear to hear.
Amen. Amen.
Our mission is to bring people in, to train them up, send them out, and to bring others back. It's kind of like a merry-go-round in that, where you go around and around, you get off for a little bit, and then you say, hey, I've got a great ride for you. Come on up and get back on the merry-go-round with me because Jesus is there and he has a good word to give us. The funny thing that just got into my head about we were just talking about why should I worry about the ups and the downs, and then I'm thinking about the carousel. ups and downs. Don't worry about the carousel. The Lord has it all handled. So we're committed to introduce you to a personal relationship with Jesus. We'll be doing this with you, and sincerely, Joni, Jeff, Pastor Scott, Stephen, Jerry, Mama Trotsky, Brett, and anybody associated with One Accord's Crusades. Amen?
Amen.
We have a plan, and we'd like you to participate in reading along and speaking. It can be found on your Facebook page if you want to do that. Otherwise, Jeff is going to help you follow. So, we seek God under number one first and put on the full armor of God. That's Ephesians 6, 10 through 18. And I'll share with you when it comes to testimony time how important that is.
Amen, sister. Amen. It sure is.
Verse 10, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Verse 11, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Those are the tricks. Those are to catch you off guard. And so if you leave it open just a little bit, that they'll try and get in there spiritually and wreck your day. That's part of my testimony, too. Verse 12, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness and wickednesses in high places. Because there's more than one wicked.
Yep.
There's wickednesses.
Yes.
It's out there. There are symbols. Show you. Keep your eye out on that and you'll see.
Amen.
Verse 13, wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, what's it say out there on Facebook? To sit or to
stand.
Arriba.
Arriba.
Stand up. God is good.
All the time.
Amen.
Amen.
So then we're going to go on to number two, that we have the three P's, which we did in our songs of praise and worship today, and what Jeff has also shared on 24:1, that the earth is his and the fullness thereof. The three P's, pray, Psalms, and Proverbs, first thing in the morning, fill up on them, because that's going to dictate the rest of your day. That's part of my testimony. Pray, and then read the books of Psalms and Proverbs for the day's day. So today is the 24th, so that's what we did. We read out of Psalms 24 and Proverbs 24. In Proverbs 24, if you got any enemies coming against you, Proverbs 24 is going to share.
Phone was ringing. Right now. Here we go. You're back. You're good.
We're back on?
Yeah.
Well, anyways, Proverbs 24, if anybody's going through a struggle out there, if the enemy's coming against and stuff, do your Ephesians 6:10, put on that armor, but also read what happens.
Auto answer, just give me, just give, yeah. Okay, here we go.
you're over there.
Okay. Thank you.
Amen. Amen.
She's helping us.
Okay, so where I left off at, before reading the Bible, pray and ask the Lord to reveal His word to you. There is something miraculously and wondrous that He wants to. I believe it's in Psalms 119, verse 18, to pray, oh Lord, to show me great and wondrous works. And even in Jeremiah 33, it says, pray unto me and I will show you great and mighty things that you do not even know. There's things the Lord wants to show you, it's just you got to be there. You can't receive it if you're out in La La Land doing whatever you want to do. Amen. So then we have our memory verse, the glory of God revealed in His Son. And I still can't get over this because a lot of the preachers are out there talking about the glory of God. Even our songs here have the glory of God. But you know what? It was revealed in His Son.
Amen.
He died on the cross. He went to hell died for those sins. Anything that is out there, even the worst of the worst, was nothing to Him. And then He rose and resurrected. He took the keys and He resurrected. Amen.
Amen.
Right now we have a lot of spiritual fights against dark and light. We know who wins, and it's God. Amen.
Amen.
And the Godhead, Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So our memory verse, let's repeat it.
And every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
You guys repeat that out there? Okay, you did a great job. Hey, I heard you guys. Originally, I heard you guys say it out there on Facebook. Yes, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Then, that's in Philippians 2:11.
Yep.
Also number 10 of Philippians 2:10, it says, and every knee shall bow and every tongue
shall confess
that Jesus Christ is Lord. And this goes on just a little bit more to solidify it, like repeating. When the Lord repeats in His word, He means it. Pay attention. All right? Number 4, pray and read before you go to sleep. Pray and read one chapter or verses from the New Testament. Sometimes I put it on my Bible app, or you can put it on your Bible app, put it on the narrative so it's vocal, and you can just listen to the lovely voice that's narrating and speaking the scriptures while you just lay there and listen and think of the good thoughts of the word that's coming into your ears. Because you want to listen to good things, not junky things. You know, good thing, junk in, junk out, good things in, good things out.
Yep.
That's the love of Jesus Christ, to show others who you serve. You wonder why the world is jealous of Christians? Because they don't have a love like we do. They don't have a Savior like we do.
Man. Come on.
The Islams, Muslims, and a lot of the people out there are going, the Lord says, not by power or by might, but by my Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
And that's where we walk by. We walk by the Spirit.
Yeah.
The power of the Spirit.
Yeah.
The power of the Word. Red words win.
Amen.
That's what Jesus said.
Woo! I love it.
Life, and nobody goes to the Father but by me.
Amen.
Red words win.
Yep.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Woo! And number 5, repeat daily and attend here. Right now at Trusty House, beautiful pool and the palm trees in the back that we're blessed to have this awesome breeze here. Awesome.
Yeah.
We're on at 2:30. If we run a little bit late, don't worry. We're getting things together so that we can present the gospel of and love of Jesus Christ to you. Amen.
Amen.
And remember, no Bible, no breakfast, no Bible, no bed.
I love it.
We have a prayer line. Amen.
Amen.
It's 1-855-70-JESUS. Not 800-855-70-JESUS. Amen.
Amen.
That concludes our the plan for now. And Jeff is gonna we're gonna have any testimonies. Do you want to go first, Jeff? Because I know that I have one too. So.
Oh well, yeah, sure. I'd love to go.
You want to go first?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. Oh, I have my own.
I'm just not used to sharing mics yet, but I have my own now. So everybody has a testimony. And this week, the enemy comes against us, especially those of us that serve you in the body of Christ. We need your prayers, because he comes against us to try to derail what we're doing here, to try to guilt us and shame us if we mess up during the week and maybe get angry or have an outbreak. I'm not perfect. I can tell you that. Maybe some preachers present themselves as perfect, and they're a lot more perfect than me, I'll tell you that. But I am not. And until the day I see Jesus, I won't be. But it's a process until then of sanctification. That's what my testimony is this week.
Amen.
That God has been sanctifying me this week by speaking to me about certain things I'm saying or not saying, and my tone of voice. And the fact that I should be interested in what other people are doing and how they're doing. Because I'm okay. The Bible tells me I'm fine. I'm seated with him in the heavenlies. My salvation is secure in him, as long as I continue in him, which I am. But he gives me the power to do that. He's the one that even wills in me to do that, it says in Ephesians, which is awesome. So my testimony this week is that, man, the enemy has really come against me with a lot of different things, but the Lord has blessed me with so many things this week, and it's been one of those weeks of ups and downs. Peaks and valleys, which that's what life is. It's peaks and valleys. There's a view in the valley that you cannot get at the mountaintop. And there's a view in the valley which you need to have and gain before you get to the mountaintop, so that you can appreciate the mountaintop for what it truly is.
Amen.
So I've discovered this by snowboarding, because I snowboard in the wintertime and when I go up to the mountains and stuff, and sometimes probably too much. But I don't do anything crazy anymore, because I know I'm not a kid. I'm over 50, so I really take it easy when I go up there, and I don't go over 50 miles an hour and all that stuff. But I'm getting off track here. I said that to say this, that this week has been peaks and valleys, and I've had some people, even in my own family, come against me with loud words and screaming and stuff. And the only thing that I can do there in that situation is just what the Bible says to do, and that's study to be quiet. And zip my mouth and have a conversation with the Lord while they're yelling at me. And all of a sudden, their yelling starts to fade. And the words have less effect. And pretty soon, I'm not even hearing them. I'm just seeing lips move, and I'm hearing from the Lord. And that's what happened to me this week. So someone that I love came against me, and I prayed for them. And it wasn't more than a half hour later, and they were really mad. And it wasn't my fault. And more than a half hour later, they texted me this really, really nice text. I'd read it to you, but my phone's busy recording the message here. But it said, "I apologize. I didn't mean to lose my temper." And you know what? That spoke to me, because I had just prayed, and in tears, I was crying out to the Lord, because it hurt me emotionally. You know, I'm an emotional person. You don't see it so much here, but I really am. In my prayer life, I'm very emotional with God.
Aww.
I get really deep and tearful in prayer. And sometimes when the Holy Spirit comes on me, I'll be praying in my prayer language, and I'm just sobbing and sobbing, and snot's running out my nose and everything. But it's holiness. That's a cleansing coming through me as I pray, and I feel that. And so God told me, shut up. Just not shut up, but he said, okay. And the scripture came to me, study to be quiet. I just read that. Okay, I'm going to do that right now, Lord. And I'm going to talk to you about the situation. And I'm going to turn around and walk the other way as this person is screaming at me, because your word says, your word gives me an out in Proverbs. Your word tells me that if I perceive not the lips of knowledge in someone, then I can depart from their presence. So that's an out. If somebody's screaming and out and yelling at you, you are absolutely 100% wise to obey the Proverbs and turn the other way and depart from their presence. You can do that. And there's so many other Proverbs. If you live by the Proverbs, if you just live by the 3,000 and somewhat Proverbs, you'll be a phenomenal Christian. You'll be an effective tool in God's hand. And that's why we read the Proverbs again and again and again, because that is the wisdom of God revealed to us. And we have the Spirit of Christ, and that ministers to us through his word. And we get that word inside of us, and it's alive and active. It's powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, says in Hebrews 4:12. So I'll get that's in my preaching, too, today. That's in the message. But the reason I'm saying this is because there may be somebody out there who I know calls for domestic violence have gone up over 1,000%. I've learned that from some of the people that take the calls. And calls for domestic violence on the lines have gone up over 1,000% since this lockdown occurred from the pandemic. So with that said, speak a kind word.
A kind answer turns away wrath.
What happened?
I don't know what happened.
Take the other one. Did you turn it off?
I might have stepped on it. I don't know.
Is the thing on?
Yeah, I turned it off on accident.
You got too excited.
I got excited and my thumb was fidgeting on the thing. So my testimony is this, that I obeyed the word, and guess what? Not only did I walk away from the person, I got out of there. The Bible tells me I can do that. If I don't perceive the lips of knowledge in someone, depart from their presence. So it gives you, and the Bible gives you, and it's not disrespectful. It's being obedient to the word.
Amen.
And maybe the other person might get mad as you're doing it, but if you're praying for them, then the Spirit of God is going to affect them in some way, especially if they are a Christian and they're going to repent. And that's exactly what happened for me this week. And I'm not even going to mention who the person is in my family. It doesn't matter. The fact,
well, it's in your family now.
The fact is that it happens in family a lot. Families fight a lot, and usually over money. The number one thing families fight over is money. So don't be fighting over that. If you're fighting over money, it must be an idol, and you need to cast that idol down, like what we said in our thing. Because we do need clean hands. But anyway, I'll get to this stuff in the message, but the Word of God, because I read it on a daily basis and do my three P's, it reproves me, and also the Lord speaks through His Spirit, through the Word. And when we obey the word, He loves that. He's smiling up there as you walk away from the other person that's screaming at you. And you start yelling, and they keep yelling, but you don't hear them, and you start hearing from the Lord. And even though you're emotional and you may be distraught, the Lord will calm that down through prayer. And that's what the topic is today, is prayer. So I just said all that to say that.
Amen. You share yours.
That's an awesome testimony, because today even on Charles Stanley and some of the other preachers were talking about forgiveness, not holding grudges, and that, so he's in line with everything. So first thing, my battery on the van that we use for ministry had gone out, and it was not even holding a charge. So I took my charger, I got it on the van, let it run and stuff, went over to Pet Boys and asked them to see what they can do, if they can replace it or what. So, and I didn't have my receipt. I had a transaction, but the transaction description wouldn't come up, and I said, well, this is $200. I got an AGM battery, one of the best, the Bosch. So, anyways, it turns out Champion bought out Bosch. So there's no more Bosch batteries out there. And so they said, well, we're going to give you a Champion AGM. I go, but it's not a Bosch. They go, oh, no, this is good. So anyways, the value on that was like $199. But they had 25% off, so it was like $149. But still, they gave me a brand new one. It's prorated back into May 22nd of 2018 when that transaction was.
Sweet.
So I still got another 2 years. If it happens to go bad, then no. Not to give me another battery or prorated, I don't know.
That's great.
But anyways, because I only have a certain amount of time to be away from the house, because I watch my mother and stuff, I was really cranky with the guy. I was really cranky. And he goes, well, just pull it around to Bay 3. I'm like, well, I can't do it. And he like looks at me. I go, well, hold start. The battery's dead. I go, you guys pull it over. So I gave him the keys, and they did their charger, and they went over there. I just wanted to wash my hands of the battery and stuff. So they put it in, then they said, oh, the van's ready. So I turned off the van to be sure that thing would turn back on, just to double check them. So I've been looking around for tires, and there's a lot of sales right now, and I'm going to get rid of the run flats. The driver's side, the sidewall is damaged, and I guess replace the whole set. So I found them calling Pet Boys back about if I order online and have a shift, what do they cover in that? And I got the same guy that helped me. His name's Daniel. So I said, Daniel, I go, will you forgive me for yesterday? I go, I was really a brat. I go, you understand? And he's like, what? It's like, I don't think he knew that people can apologize. And we had a really good rapport. So I know that with a soft answer turns off wrath, and
yep.
my getting bold to say, yes, I'm sorry, and that to him. Because he would say, no, it's okay. I go, well, you know, no, it's okay, because I know that you deal with it all day long and that, but it's who I represent. And because I'm a Christian. So the thing of it is, I think more ministry, if I go back there, it's going to happen. And that those seeds planted of forgiveness and love of Jesus Christ will bring him
wow.
to the altar of repentance and asking the Lord into his life.
Wow. So,
that's one of the good way the Lord works. It's okay to say, I'm sorry. I didn't mean it. You know, you had all this stuff going, and this is not my character. We're supposed to have the characteristics of Jesus Christ. And this leads to the next one. Phil, if you're out there, Pastor Scott knows, and he I think he already told you a little bit about this, but I'm going to do it on this broadcast of Facebook. But yesterday, about 11 o'clock, I was sitting in the front having my coffee and my oatmeal, and the doorbell goes off. I'm like, well, who's coming? I don't have any nurses or doctors today and that. So there's this young girl. They're probably about 5'2", a little pixie blonde. And I'm like, yes, may I help you? And she looked kind of a little distraught, like she needed some help. And she goes, oh, I need to call for a taxi and that. My cell phone is dead. I need to get to my grandma's house. And I'm like, okay. So why did you stop at this house? Because you have all these Jesus signs around. And the man is on the car, and then I have something that Phil had given me on the cardboard printouts. And I was just like, oh my gosh. I go, this is the first time anybody had stepped in. I mean, I've had JW stop in, but I thought that we wound up challenging each other in the Bible. I give him the scriptures, John 1:1, 1:14, John 14:6, and of such. And this girl's asking for help. And I'm like, oh my gosh, Lord, thank you so much.
Yay.
So anyways, we get to talking. She's got her stuff in a stroller. She says she's from New Mexico, but she's out here and stuff. And I said, well, do you know Jesus? And, oh yeah, Jesus lives in Chicago. He's my husband.
Oh, wow.
I'm like, whoa, what are we dealing with here, Joni? That's why I'll get to it, Ephesians 6:10. So she's telling me about how she has this relationship with God. Oh, yeah, he's really good. And he says, she's going to see my ring. I'm the wife. I'm like, well, he has many brides. Anyways, and then she's saying that she needed to get to her grandma's house. She needed to have a taxi. Can you call for me? Can you call my grandma? So she didn't give me the grandma's number. I said, well, do you have money for the taxi? She goes, oh, yeah, I got a 20. Do you have any change? And I go, I'm not going to go there. So she had the money. So I called up somebody to come and get her. And then when the van pulled up, it was a brand new van. There was no markings on it that it is a taxi or anything. It was nice and clean, but because if it was a woman, she might have taken it, but because it was a man, she had been violated in the past. She had some guy that was pimping her out and all this stuff.
Oh,
and I told her, I said, you know, if you're a bride of Jesus, why are you allowing somebody to pimp you out? Well, you have to do that in order to survive. I go, no, you don't. If you truly have a relationship with the Lord, you need to trust him. He takes care of the birds in the air and the lilies in the field. Why wouldn't he want to take care of you?
Yeah.
She, like, thought about it. She goes, well, I'm the last Samaritan woman, or Samaritan or whatever woman. I'm like, okay. She's really off her rocker. So we're not dealing with a full deck here, 5150. But I'm praying for her. And I go in the house. I go, I have some refrigerated food on the patio, front patio. I go, are you hungry? And so I gave her two lunches and some milks and that. She was so appreciative. Then I went inside.
Wow.
She had coughed. And she took her hand and put it on her mouth,
oh.
all the slime, and she put it on her clothes. Well, I can't really deal with that because I care for my mother.
Yep, totally.
So I said, hey, let's go and rinse off your hand. And so I have a hose in the front. Oh, she didn't want to do that. Well, I have kitties in the front, and I have a gallon of water that I pour into their water bowl. So I went and I grabbed that, and I said, let's go out in front and let me rinse off your hands. So we did that. I said, let me, I'll be right back. I have to go check on the other people that live here because I'm not the owner of the home. And so I went in the bathroom and I got some washcloth to give her. And so she was very appreciative. Then she says, oh, do you need clothes? You want this and that? Can I pick some of your weeds? So she wasn't like the normal homeless person, but she did ask my name. She said, oh, when's your birthday? I go, it's in the fall. I'm not going to give out any personal information because we, in our neighborhood, we've had a rising of some of the homeless people and car break-ins and GTAs, Grand Theft Autos. And I just don't want to go there to give out too much information that she would bring somebody back to the house. I'm very protective of my mom and the property, along with praying for the angels, Michael and Gabriel there. But the blessing of it is she refused the taxi. She gave me her brother's phone number, so I called and no answer. I left a message. And then he called back later on. But he didn't say anything. So, and it was a New Mexico number, so I know everything was kind of lining up. So anyways, I was able to pray for her. Oh, I started speaking in tongues. Don't do that! Don't do that! You can't speak in tongues around me. So why? If you're spirit filled. So there was a demonic nature in her. And then she had her arm out and she had cutting.
Oh, man.
And that, and I go, oh boy, we're dealing with this. When I went to go get those washcloths in the bathroom, I put on the Ephesians 6:10 because I was still in my morning devotions and stuff, and I hadn't gotten there yet. I put it on real quick because I didn't know what I was dealing with. I said, Lord, cover me with your blood from the crown of my head to the soles of the feet in this household and property. So from then on, I was able to pray for her. She actually didn't kind of want it, but I think she did want it. I think the Lord had a divine appointment there. Thing is, I got to get up earlier. It showed me that you don't know what your day is going to be. That's why you put on that Ephesians 6:10 and you pray and you do your discipleship rounds to invite the Lord into your day because you never know. And so it just put me in check. And it might put, you know, sometimes we want to run our own show when we want to go to the Lord. But he has a divine purpose for us to get up early and rise. There's even the 3 to 6 a.m. time slot, the Jewish fourth hour. But
yes.
he wants you to get up and rise and let that let the prayer cover your day. Let the scriptures cover your day because you don't know what's going to come against you. So even though it's not coming against me, I got a phone call today for asking for a bae. I'm like, who's bae? And the guy hung up because her name was actually Emily. What she told me. I don't know if that phone number was associated with anything of the temp or anything. But I did I also texted the brother, and he said, thank you for showing my sister God's grace. That brought tears to me because you never know who else is praying. You can be that instrument to touch somebody's life that's going through a lot of crap and stuff. And she had grown up in a foster home. And so I said, oh, I know a lot about that. I know a lot about social services and stuff. And when people make up lies against your parents and that, and they want to take and give to bad people, and you're the good person. And anyway, she says she surely did miss her mom very much. And the one last thing out of this is that she said every daughter needs their mama.
Wow.
And that made me want to cry because my daughter being up in Washington, and everything that how the enemy came in to separate us, and I'm producing all this evidence that, hey, I was always there. It's these people that see how good she is that they want to try and corrupt her mind. That's what the enemy wants to do to our youth. They want to corrupt their minds. I saw a little meme. What's the difference between the zombies and what's the difference of a bunch of kids standing up against a wall like this? They had about four zombies on there like this with their head down, and they showed four kids against the wall with their heads in their phones. What's the difference? The agenda is making them into zombies.
Yeah.
Well, we stand against that for our youth. So anyways, that's my praise report, Phil. It was awesome because the brother texted me back about showing God's grace and that she stopped in because of the signs. If I didn't have a sign there, she might have walked on to another house that might have just, you know, beat her up or something like that.
Yeah, so you never know.
God knows where to plant people to get counsel, love, and prayer, and show them the right way planting the seeds. Amen?
Amen.
All right, Jeff.
And then, wow. Wow. That's amazing.
It was an amazing experience.
Really amazing. I know you didn't tell me that, but I'm glad.
I was saving it.
I'm glad you saved it and shared it.
What an awesome testimony that gives God the glory. You know, that's one of those testimonies that you love to hear stuff like that. God's grace.
Tell them to be sure and order their magnets.
Be sure and order your magnets.
You put them on your cars.
Put them on your cars, and they keep taking them off my car, but I pray over my magnets. So if they take it off the car, and even if they throw it away or whatever they do with it, they're going to get a blessing. They're going to get conviction of the Holy Ghost. They are. Prayer has a definite effect that we don't see sometimes till much, much later, sometimes instantly, sometimes a half hour later, like with me and my testimony this week, and sometimes way in the future, but God honors it. The main thing about prayer is that you do it, and I'll say that at the end of the message too, and that's how I'm going to begin this, because the main thing about prayer is that you just talk to God and tell him how you're feeling. He cares about everything. He cares about every hair on your head, and not one of them can fall without his will. And not one sparrow that's flying over us can fall out of the sky without his will. He's sovereign over everything. And I thank God that he is, because, man, we might be in trouble if the elements got a little bit out of whack and we got maybe a CME coming off the sun and it knocked out all of our electronics. We'd be in big trouble. But he regulates everything because he's sovereign and he loves you and cares about you, even though you may think you're a little person and that you're insignificant to him. That is not the case. Jesus had you in mind when he died on the cross. Anyway, so I'm going to get into the message here. Our theme is the glory of God revealed in his son, Jesus Christ. And how does that glory, how does the glory in Greek, the word is doxa, how does that glory, and it's mentioned 161 times in the King James Version in 153 different verses. So how does that glory help us to pray? That's what we're going to be looking at today. So how does it help us to pray, or how does it help us in prayer for the knowledge that we share in that glory too, by virtue of the revelation of Jesus' prayer to the Father, his high priestly prayer to the Father in John 17. And so we're going to look at a couple verses there. We're going to be going all over the place, so get out your Bibles, make sure they're ready to be used. And if you have a Bible and you haven't picked it up for a long time, please do pick it up. It's the Word of God. It will bless your life. Just reading it. Just reading one verse will bless you.
Amen.
And then it'll get you addicted too, like I am. And then you can't put it down. And you always have it. You have them all over your car and all over your bed. I have 3 Bibles on my bed open right now, I think. I haven't even closed them. I just kept them open. And I'll get back to them when I get back home. But
no sticky pages.
Yeah. They have sticky pages because I eat sometimes. I snack when I do, you know, once in a while. But I have wipes there because I, especially when I'm borrowing somebody's Bible, then I have a procedure I go through. I wash my hands before I even open it up. And so I've washed my hands today. They're clean hands, and God has cleaned them too, so they're extra clean. So thank you for that. So, Father, I pray for your children and your pre-believers out there, Lord, that they'd come to you today. And I pray for everybody that they would have ears to hear, that you would open the eyes of our hearts, that we could receive your engrafted word, Lord, that it would spring up into us, into beautiful fruit trees that other people would want to come and eat off of, that they'd want to come and pick our fruit and have some of the delicious Holy Spirit that revives us and refreshes us. And so we thank you so much, Holy Spirit, that you're here with us and in us and for us.
Amen.
You're awesome. So we give you praise, God, and Father, Son, Holy Ghost, we praise you, and we thank you for what you're about to speak through me. Let it be your words, and guide me, guide my tongue, guide my brain to where you'd have it to go right now. I'm here, and I'm available for you, so I thank you for that. Please speak to your people today in a mighty way. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
So this week has been a great week. I worked full-time as some of you know, not most of you, I'd say most of you, but I don't know that. Some of you know that I do work full-time and have a very vigorous physical labor job, but it's a very high-paying labor job, probably one of the highest-paying labor jobs you can get, as divers are very high-paid. And I'm very grateful for that we have been able to continue working. In my field, I'm definitely essential because I can operate a hyperbaric chamber. I'm a dive master, so I know just about everything about it. And I've forgotten probably more than I've learned at this point because I haven't practiced a lot of the commercial stuff lately. But how that ties into this message is that in my diving, I noticed that it's my prayer time at work. That's how this ties in. I have a dedicated prayer time. I don't know if any of you guys do, but I dedicate as soon as I wake up. Thank you, God. I open my eyes. Oh, I'm alive. All right. I get to shine your light today. And then I pray. I read my Bible. I make my coffee. I drink a sip of coffee here and there. I have a cup of coffee in the morning, a small cup, too. And I don't make it super strong because I don't like it bitter. And I like a lot of cream and stevia in it. I don't use sugar. I just use stevia now. So, and it has an aftertaste, but I'm used to that now. It's not the real thing, but I'm used to the fakeness of it, I guess. So I do that, and then I pray in my car as I go. I usually listen to part of a message, 20 minutes or so, and that gets me really into prayer. And then at work, I get to pray all day because I'm underwater, and I lay hands on the boats and bless the people's boats. And if they're not saved, Lord, get them. I pray, Lord Jesus, convict them and bring them to you and bring them into your family. And so I get to talk to the people on their boats, so, and especially lately, but I dive underwater, and I'm praying under there almost all day long. So I have hours of prayer in every day is what I do, and that's one of my gifts, so I get to use it there. And wherever you're at, I just want to say this today. If you don't know what your spiritual gifts are, pray to God to reveal them to you, and he will. He definitely will, because he wants you to operate in the gifts he's given you. Now, he can operate any gift through you if you're willing, if you're surrendered, and you're doing his will and doing his work. He could operate the gift of prophecy through me right now if he wanted to. He could speak a word to me. He has spoken words and prophetic words through me, and they've come to pass. And it's amazing how it's happened, and I've seen it unfurl. And I was saying, there may be a rainbow today. That would be great. And then all of a sudden, there's two or three rainbows around us at the park. It was awesome. Then he's spoken prophetic words through me through people, and things have happened for them. And I didn't know it. And at one time, he spoke a prophetic word, and it was so strong in me. The word was, you're going to be healed. You're going to be healed. And the girl sitting right next to me, I was in a meeting, and the girl sitting right next to me, and somebody else was talking. So I thought, and it kept coming to me, you're going to be healed, when I looked at her. And I just looked at her, and I said, you know, God is speaking to me right now. And he says, you're going to be healed. And she started crying immediately. Oh, that's so good, because they say I'm dying of cancer and stuff like that. And guess what? She's still alive today, and that was years ago.
Amen.
So it's amazing how God can work through you and give you, work any gift in you and through you. But one of mine is prayer, intercession. That's one of the things that I'm deep into. And so that's why I love to preach on this message of prayer, because it's something I do a lot and something I have seen the rewards of, and I've been healed supernaturally by prayer, through praying. It says the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and that is so true. And I've had Pastor Scott lay hands on me, and things have disappeared out of my life that I didn't want. And it's just amazing the amount of things that God will work through prayer. Because he's sovereign, he works through praise too as well, and he works through us shining our light. But he does work through prayer a lot, and I'm just going to go into a couple of things about prayer. But first, I'm going to talk about glory, because how does the glory of God revealed in his Son help us to pray, or help us in prayer, or in the process of prayer? Well, let's look at the word glory first and see what is meant by the word glory. In Greek, it's the word doxa, D-O-X-A. It's pronounced the same as it looks in Greek, doxa. It's Strong's G-1391 in the Strong's Concordance. The G stands for Greek. It's a feminine noun, which it means opinion, judgment, view, splendor, brightness, magnificence. All of those descriptions can paint pictures in our imaginations of the light and the stars and the galaxy and the immensity of it all, and how eternal it appears when we look at, say, a Hubble image on our phone. I have one on my screensaver. I think it's called the Eye of God is what they named it, and it's a huge cloud of different gases, and it looks like a giant eye in space that's trillions of miles wide. It's just glorious. If you look up that Eye of God on the Hubble images for the Hubble telescope, you'll see it's beautiful, and I use that as my screensaver on my phone. Joni's probably looking it up right now. So the glory of God. Now, all the stars in the galaxies and everything in this earth, the mountains, the snow-covered hills, the beautiful deserts with their flowers and cacti, all of these things are but a reflection of his glory. They're just a reflection, like if you see yourself in a mirror, or if you see the reflection of a mountain in a calm, crystal-clear lake in Alaska, where it's super clear and there's no smog, and you see that reflection in it. All of this stuff, all of the stuff in the natural is just a reflection of his glory. Now, glory, doxa. Well, we know that all of this light, and that's the reason we can see, we know that all of this light is, and the light from the stars are a reflection of his glory. And light is the second strongest force in nature. The first strongest force in nature is gravity. We know that light can be bent by the gravity of a singularity, which I believe God is, in a sense, a singularity, but a singularity that encompasses all, a singularity that has no beginning or end. So that's kind of my philosophical take on who God is. It's kind of probably really shallow, but who he is so awesome and immense that we can't even begin to imagine it, even if we were to live a billion years. And we are going to live forever, which is an amazing thing. And that we're going to actually get an upgrade to a celestial body when we see Christ. He's going to give us a new body. When he comes back for his church, the dead in Christ shall rise first, and then those which remain will be caught up with him in the air, into the third heaven, or where, whatever dimension he's in. Or I don't know how it's going to happen, but it will happen. And so praise God for that. And we may see it in our lifetime. If he should tarry, we need to continue on his work. So how does his kingly majesty, his glory, I call it his kingly majesty. That's my description of it. Which is eternal. How does that help us to pray? Well, number one, his glorious resurrection power has made us alive in Christ. I think that's important because the resurrection is the most important doctrine in the Christian faith. Without the resurrection, none of the other Christian faith stands. So, because we know that he raised from the dead on the third day, and that we have that in us because we're co-inheritors with us, him in all things, and we're seated in the heavenlies with Christ, by which we have access to the Father through Christ, and now the veil has been torn. So we have access straight to the throne of grace. And that's where we pray. We go to his throne of grace. That's in Hebrews. And that's Hebrews 4:16, where it says that. And I think I'll turn there. It's very important that we see. Well, we know the word is all powerful. We looked at that during our study the week before last. So I'm going to turn to Hebrews really quick. I don't even have a tab. So you can turn with me. And maybe some of you scholars will be there before me. So I'm here. Hebrews chapter 4. And so we know 4:12 says, "For the word of God is quick or alive and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit." And we can't even see the spirit, but it divides that from the soul. We can't even see the soul either. "And of the joints and marrow," well, we can see that, "and as a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart." So it can discern the thoughts, the very intents, the intents, the place where the stuff starts in the heart. So I ask you, what is the intent of your heart today in prayer?
Amen.
What is the intent of your heart today in prayer? Is the intent that you're going to get something for yourself? I mean, you could call debt cancellation on all your stuff, and God can honor that, but are you praying for missionaries? Are you praying for those that are working in the body of the Christ that needs? Are you praying for your pastors daily? Are you praying for me? I need prayer daily. I'm an evangelist, so I really need prayer. So those are just a few questions we can ask ourselves. But the reason that we come to Christ is because he loves us and wants us to pray. The Bible tells us in numerous places to pray always, even at the end of our spiritual warfare, on our armor, putting on the armor. It says, pray always with all prayer and all supplication for the saints, right there at the end of the chapter, chapter 6 of Ephesians. And then, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace, God's riches at Christ's expense. God's riches at Christ's expense. Grace, that we don't get what we do deserve. And then mercy, what we do get what we don't deserve. But to find grace to help in time of need. Well, I don't know about you, but I am in need. I'm a really one of those needy kids. I'm a needy child of God. And I need more of him most. I need more of his presence, more of his power, more of his intuition, more of his inspiration in my mind. Inspiration, that word comes from the word spirit. Inspiration, to be inspired, that means to be inspired by the Spirit of God. That's where that comes from. So, in him we are priests and kings. A priest's duty is to pray. So, we can see that all throughout the Old Testament. The priest's main duty was to pray, make atonement for the people, take their sacrifices. Today, we have Jesus who sacrificed himself. We don't need to offer sacrifices anymore because we have the fulfilling of the new covenant in Christ and the sealing of it with his resurrection. That sealed the new covenant. When he was done, when he said it is finished, he had yet to raise, but he did go to hell, like what Johnny was saying. Abraham's bosom is what it was called back then. Now it's just a part of Abraham's bosom that's no more. He took captivity captive and gave gifts to men. So Abraham and Elijah and all those guys are up there with the Father now, with all the saints who have been martyred and with all the saints who have passed before us. And so they're there with him now. And we'll be there with him too, because absent from the body is to be present with the Lord.
Amen.
So we'll be there with him someday soon. Praise God. So how does the glory, the majesty, the overwhelming majesty of God help us to pray? Well, when we realize that he wants us to share in that glory, and that's what we're going to see right now when we turn to John chapter 17, and I did mention that. John chapter 17, verse 22 is the verse I'm going to look at for us today. We're going to be looking at it together. John 17:22. This is one of the most amazing statements that comes out. Amazing statement, but it's a supplication. It's a request from the Father. Jesus is in perfect union and perfect harmony with the Father, and he always has been, until he said to Telestai, at which point their fellowship was broken, and that's why he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? That's why it says that in the song. And so we see that it's because that he took the penalty for our sin, which was the breaking of fellowship with the Father. That's why he's called the second Adam, because he restored that fellowship that he created Adam for and that he created us for. And so we are now restored in fellowship, so that's why we need to talk to him, because now we are restored with him. But we're going to see from John 17, verse 22, Jesus praying to the Father. This is the 20th verse of prayer in this book, in this chapter. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them. What? Jesus said, and the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them. That's us. That they may be one. What is that one talking about? What does that one mean? That one means unity. That one means in one accord. That's why we're called One Accord. Shout out to the person that came up with the name for that. I'm pretty sure it was Pastor Scott. I'm pretty sure he was in deep prayer by reading the book of Acts as he came across that. And he goes, yeah, that's what we're going to call it, One Accord. What a great name. I love this name probably more than, and I'm partial to it because I'm a part of this ministry, but I love this name more than just about the name of any other church there is out there. One Accord Crusades. And I mean, I do like Harvest Crusades. I love Greg Laurie. He's one of my favorite you know, evangelist of this day. And he started out small too, like I am. So you never know, you may see Jeff Turner in a stadium sometime. But I don't need that. I just want to lead people to the Lord. I just want people to have the peace and joy and the satisfaction inside my soul that I have. That's what I want you to have. If you don't have that today, you get a chance to get a taste of that and get a chance to get more and more of that as you get into a deeper love relationship with your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If he's not your Lord and Savior yet, just stick around, because you're going to get an opportunity for that to happen for you today. So Jesus continued on with that thought, I in them and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one. That word one again. And that speaks of unity. That speaks of one accord. And that the world may know that thou hast sent me and thou hast loved them as thou hast loved me. I want to stop right there. A very important thing. Is anybody going to know if you're his disciple, or if I'm his disciple, or if Joni or Scott or any of us are his disciples, unless we have love for each other, unless we're in one accord? Because if we're in one accord, which we are, you know, if somebody gets off a little bit, we say, oh, you made a mistake there. And, oh, okay. Joni's a very humble administrator. She's our administrator here. She's wearing all the hats today. Administrator, stand up. What do you call it? Delivery. I don't know how many positions are in the church, but she's done quite a few. And I get to do them today, too, because we don't have a lot of help. But usually we have people at the park, and everybody's willing to just put down whatever they're doing, their deep conversations, and get into helping us set up so that we can serve. And so that we can meet the spiritual needs and physical needs of the people that are in transition in the park. And I can't wait to get back there. I've been going by there religiously a couple times a week, and the tape's still up, and it's still blocked off, and the kids can't swing on the swings unless they go all the way to Newport Beach, and then all the parks are open there because the kids have torn all the stuff off the swings in there, and the mothers, everybody's letting them play. And the kids are even social distancing. It's kind of cool to see that everybody's kind of trying to be obedient and do their part. So that's good. And I just think it's important for us to see this, that Jesus wants us to be, and that's his goal of this whole entire prayer, to sanctify us, to have us be one in him, and to bring us into perfect unity. That's why there are many parts in the body of Christ, but that Paul says, hey, just because you're the toe, don't say I'm not of the neck or the mouth because I'm the toe. You know, you need a toe for support so the rest of the body can stand up. Or if you're the heart that's just pumping it, nobody even sees you, and you might feel unappreciated in the body of Christ. But if you're the heart of the body of Christ, then you're in prayer a lot, and then you can pray for people. And prayer has an awesome dynamic effect on not only me when I pray, it changes my heart as I pray. Because the Holy Spirit is working through that prayer. And he works with groanings which cannot be uttered, too, as well. So that's another thing, besides the prayer language, besides me praying in the Spirit, which I do many times a day. I'm not trying to say I'm better than anybody because I'm doing that. It's just a habit I've gotten into of praying a lot. Because when I go by a bus stop and I see somebody that looks like, hey, they might be on drugs or that's passed out on a bus stop, sometimes I'll stop and give them a drink of water, you know, put something over them so they don't get sunburned, or I'll pray, at least pray for them as I go by. And hey, Lord, give them a better life than I have and a better car than I. If you really have the Spirit of God and are praying and you're in touch with the Father and what he's doing, then you'll want other people to succeed. You'll want to let somebody in line before you. The other day I was at a 7-Eleven, and I was going in there to buy Reese's peanut butter cups. I had this craving. I wanted to get a Reese's peanut butter cup. And this Muslim lady and her daughter are walking up, and they're, you know, I could have just kind of walked a little faster, but the Lord said, no, smile, say hi, be really loving, open the door for them. And they didn't want to go in at first. I said, sure, go on in, ladies first. You know, I said that. And they said, thank you. So I said, you're welcome. And then they were able to get in line before me. And I was cool with it. It didn't matter to me. What mattered to me is that I was showing the love of the Lord and that I was in tune enough to pray real quick right there, Lord. You know, what should I do? When you stop and even consider something to ponder it, Well, that's a time where you can pray. That's a time where you can send up a quick little prayer and you can plant a seed. And maybe that lady will wonder why I did that. I was hoping to talk to her and her daughter and tell her that Jesus loved them, you know? And so I wanted to, evangelize to them, but it wasn't the time to. But anyway, I got to do a kind deed. I'm just saying, that's the things that we do throughout the day. Is, I want somebody else to get in line, so I let people in on the freeway. I don't try to, make sure that they don't get in because I'm going to punish them because they're trying to get ahead of everybody else. No, I don't do any of that. I'm calm in my car because I'm prayed up. When you're prayed up, you'll stay prayed up, and you'll keep praying. I mean, you never get prayed up to the point where you don't need to pray anymore. That's not the case. And so the disciples... So we are coming up on Pentecost, and so if you'll turn with me to Acts, I want to preach out of Acts because it's a very important chapter. Thank God that we are we're in Acts 28 or 20, 29 or 30 right now, which isn't in the Bible, but we're actually writing that. We're actually part of, because the Acts of the Apostles never stops. The book did stop. It had all God needed in it to give us great history and theology, but. We are still writing the book of Acts because we are still in this dispensation of grace right now. Thank God we are. And so as we see the biblical prophecies unfolding in these last days, I don't know, if there's a lot of you are students of prophecy out there. And as we see that these one prophecy after another, the earthquakes, the nation rising against nation, the famines and pestilence everywhere. This could be called a pestilence, the COVID-19, all these viruses and stuff are pestilence. Of course, I think it's being used for other purposes, but we know that God is with us, and we don't have to fear. We do not have to fear, and prayer takes away fear. For me, when I get into prayer, I get reassured in my spirit with something that is not tangible to me, but it's there. It's Him, it's God in me, the hope of Christ in me, the hope of glory inside of me, letting me know, hey, everything's going to be okay. Great peace, the Word says, have they that love thy law, and nothing shall offend them, it says in Isaiah 26:3. So, that's another verse. But I want to go to Acts chapter 1. So, what was happening here in Acts is, the apostles, okay.
What chapter? I'm sorry.
Chapter 1. Oh. Acts. So Luke wrote this, the Acts of the Apostles, as well as the Gospel of Luke, and he was a doctor, and he wrote it in a real doctrinally, scholarly way, very descriptive. So I'll just read from one on and explain as I go down. So chapter 1, the former treatise. Have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up, after that he, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, and so to whom he also shewed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days. He showed himself to over 500 people during his resurrected body, having not yet gone to the Father yet, and speaking of the things that pertaining to the kingdom of God, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which he saith, ye have heard of me. And that's when Jesus said, you shall be baptized by the Holy Spirit. You will receive the Comforter. If I'm not taken from you, the disciples were all, they're wondering among themselves who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven and stuff like that. Not even too concerned, because I don't think they understood the gravity of what was going to happen to Jesus yet. But what the disciples did is they were arguing among themselves. And Jesus said, Jesus, I'm just putting it in paraphrasing. Jesus said, you're going to have the Holy Spirit come and teach you and guide you into all things. You don't have to worry about any of this stuff. That's basically what he was saying in a nutshell. So, and the disciples were doing this, at the Last Supper, even. They were in their minds. It's so funny. We're just like them in a lot of ways. But wait for the promise of the Father, which saith, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. The words of Christ. Now, this is coming from the risen Savior. When they therefore come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom of Israel? And he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power, but ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses. That's why the power of the Holy Spirit comes upon us, so that we can be witnesses. Unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all of Judea and Samaria, and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. When he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. That's awesome. Probably like a similar cloud that was guiding the, Moses in the desert for 40 years. A pillar of fire by night, a cloud by day, and a pillar of fire by night. Probably a similar cloud, I would think. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel. Those are called angels. Which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. Then returned they into Jerusalem from the Mount Olivet, which is from Jerusalem a Sabbath day's journey. Now, which for us would be about an hour in the car. And when they were come in, they went up into an upper room. This is what I want to focus on, where abode both Peter and James and John and Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, and Matthew, and James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon, Zelotes, and Judas, the brother of James. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, with his brethren. So I want to focus on that verse 14. They continued in one accord. And after this, the promise of the Holy Ghost comes, and we'll see what happens. And it's an amazing thing. So this is a call, church, for us to come, all of us, into one accord, into the love of God. And quit the name calling, quit the hatred, quit the social media addictions, because that stuff is made to be addictive. They have an R&D department in Facebook and in Google and in Twitter. Well, Twitter's part of Facebook, owns all that stuff. They have an R&D department that they put hundreds of millions into just to make it super addictive, okay? They do that. And I don't know if you guys know this, but this is the truth. And they do a really good job at it. So shout out to Facebook. You make it highly addictive, and I like it a lot myself. And I use it as a tool for the Lord. So thank you, Facebook, for not censoring us yet. Maybe you will someday, but not yet. But we pray for you, Mark Zuckerberg, that you will come to Jesus, and that you will have a great experience in your Christian walk. Anyway, so, and in those days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples and said, the number of names together were about 120. Whoa, wouldn't it be great if we could get 120 men and women to come to a prayer meeting? You know, in the church, the meeting that is the least attended in any church is the prayer meeting. And that should not be, brothers and sisters. We all are called to pray. We all are called to pray without ceasing, like it says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Pray without ceasing. It's the will of God that we pray without ceasing, that we rejoice forevermore, that we, in all things we give thanks. That's all the will of God for us, is that we pray without ceasing. So I can't hammer that point home enough. Pray without ceasing. Pray always with all prayer and supplication for the saints, in chapter 6 of Ephesians. So Peter stood up and said, men and brethren, this scripture must needs have been fulfilled, which the Holy Ghost by the mouth of David spake before concerning Judas, which was the guide of them that took Jesus. So yeah, David did speak of this, and he spoke about it in the Psalms. For he was numbered with us and obtained part of this ministry, and so Psalm 41:9 there is a reference, and obtained part of this ministry. Now this man purchased a field with the reward of iniquity, and falling headlong, he burst asunder in the midst, and his bowels gushed out. Now, that doesn't say that he specifically died by that happening, although that would kill you. But maybe God had that mercy, because maybe he was really going through a lot of pain with the noose around his neck, or however it was. And maybe God just had a bird land on the branch, and that broke the branch. However it happened, I believe the branch broke. And in that area, in Jerusalem, I've never been there, but I've seen pictures, there's like it's a hill, it's steep, there's a cliff there. And he could have fallen off the cliff, and a sharp rock cut him open. And a lot of people say, well, that's how he died here. And that contradicts the other scripture that said, but it doesn't, it just contrasts it. Okay, there's something called a contradiction, and there's something called a contrast. And a contrast is just basically a difference between two colors that mesh together. And a contradiction is one thing is true and the other is not. A contrast, both can be true, just different shades of the same color. Okay, that's the best way I have of explaining this, because I've had people come. And so that's a little bit of apologetics for you out there, in case you didn't know. So this is not saying that he didn't die that way, and the other one's not saying that he didn't die this way. So therefore, it's contrast. So, just to get that out of the way, I think that was good that I focused on. And it was known unto all the dwellers at Jerusalem, insomuch as the field is now called in the proper name, in the proper tongue, Asteldama, that is to say, the field of blood. So it's written in the Psalms, and that's in Psalm 69:25. It was written in the Psalms, let his habitation be desolate, let no man dwell therein, his bishopric let another take. And then they, I'll just sum up the rest of the chapter. They did lots to get Matthias to be take his place.
Can I share something real quick?
Sure, yeah, absolutely.
On the dig, by Lightfoot, says that the devil took Judas up in the air and dashed his body on the ground after strangling him. Luke records that some extraordinary catastrophe occurred and he fell mutilating himself.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
Oh, that's awesome. You see, so there's much more to be said on this topic right here, the subject. I was just saying that is not a contradiction in the Bible, although people have falsely called it that because they don't understand the difference between contrast and contradiction. And so I just wanted to give you a brief lesson in apologetics there. So the point of this entire chapter is the beginning of the history of the church. Now, and the reason why, and I have a Seventh Day Adventist, well, you know, you guys don't celebrate on the front. No, well, yes, we do, because the church met on the first day of the week, says so in Acts chapter 20, verse 7. So it does say that in Acts chapter 20, that the church began to meet on the first day of the week, which is our Sunday. And that's why we do that. So I just wanted, in case anybody wanted to learn that, now you've learned that. So prayer. Being in one accord, corporate prayer. I cannot stress enough how, and we do this on One Accord Crusades, we have a prayer line, and I get on it, and I put a big bunch of hands on there, and the bigger the hands is, that means the more prayers I've said, and the more I have to say, and then we pray for every request that comes on there, and I scroll back through all the stuff I missed, because thank God Facebook tells me how much stuff I missed. And I go back and I scroll through it and I go through every request, and if one stands out to me, the Holy Spirit will have me pray in the Spirit over it. So it's an amazing thing, prayer. It's a privilege and an honor and a duty for all of us as Christians to pray. It's a privilege because the grace of God, the glory of God, gives us perspective on how big and massive and awesome He is, and the fact that we get to share in that awesome glory. Not only do we get to share in it, but we get to get a little bit of it. Not for ourselves, just so that we can shine His light. So that people can see, wow, not that Jeff is glorified. No, I'm going to glorify Jesus. I'm going to point you to Him. And if you say, oh, Jeff, you're awesome. What a great message. No, He's awesome. He's the best. I'm just the messenger carrying a message in my heart because I know He's real. Because I know He loves me, and He loves you, and He saved me, and He wants to save you. If you're not saved yet, if you haven't received Christ yet, today you'll get a chance to do that. A couple more points to look at. Besides the beginning of the church, and For all intents and purposes, we could be the end of the church. We could be the last generation. And indeed, Israel was formed in a day back in 1946 in March, and so, or 1947, so they became a nation. And now we've recognized Jerusalem as the capital. No president has done that, although they all promised that they were going to do that, but Trump came through on that promise. So shout out to Trump. And if there's any haters or whatever, we are not of those that hate. We love, and we pray, and we love haters, and we don't hate. The only thing that we hate is the own very evil in our own hearts that tries to well up and get nasty or judgmental or, you know, whine or cry or complain. And complaining is a huge sin. It's one of the biggest that God hates, is the complaining. That's what, because we have every reason to be thankful. We've been given life. It's a beautiful gift. We've been given a lot of beautiful things to look at in this earth. I mean, I can't even go through all the bugs with my daughter on the list of how many different insects, millions of different insects that there are. I can't even go through the list with her in the next 5 years. I probably couldn't get through the list of insects that God created, let alone birds and other species and sea life. He's glorious. He's majestic, and all this is just a reflection of his glory. Now, if you read Revelation, the book of Revelation, you will see his glory revealed in some thumbnail sketches in there of what heaven's going to be like, and the pearly gates, and the 12 foundations of heaven, which are different types of crystal, I guess. It's just beautiful. It's glorious. The jewels that make up the foundation of heaven, Jesus being the chief cornerstone, it's glorious. So, number one, his glorious resurrection power has made us alive in Christ, by which we have access to him. Access because he tore the veil. Access to his throne of grace, to bring requests there, to bring our heart there, to get right with him. So, this helps us because his grace is glorious, and we know who we are in him, like I said. So, I have a lot of different verses that I came up with, and I think that the one that probably shows his power the most is Hebrews chapter 1, and it shows his deity too as well. So I want to have you guys turn there real quick. Just Hebrews 1, we'll end it up in Hebrews 1, I think. Yeah, it's a nice one. I love that Bible. I've been using it a lot. I've been trying to take good care of it so I don't stretch it out too much for it. I don't want to mess it up. I tend to be rough on my equipment. You can see the case. Thank God we have the case. It got a little damp from a towel or something. I apologize. But you can trade me cases if you want. Either way, I took the Bible out as soon as I saw the case was a little warped. I'm like, oh no! I'm like, am I going to have to replace this? But no, I didn't. Thank God the case just got a little warped. So Hebrews chapter 1 really shows off who he is and the glory. So I'll just start at verse 1. God, who at sundry, that means various times and various manners, spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed to be heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, all the planets and everything. That's what that means. Who, being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person. You remember right now, Jesus said, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. And upholding all things by the word of his power. That word upholding means carrying, consisting, holding together, bringing through. It has a lot of different meanings in Greek. I forget the precise word, but I've read it before. By the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high, being made so much better than the angels, as he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. That's what we were talking about in Philippians, a couple of verses. Philippians 9, I think it says that he gave him a name above every name, that at that name every knee should bow, things in heaven and earth and under earth, that at the name of Jesus every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. and you can do that today. And then you don't have to ever worry about, you know, not being his or his wrath, you know, because you're saved from all that. For unto which of the angels said he at any time, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee? This is a glorious truth in this chapter. I believe that Paul wrote this, that Paul is bringing out. And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. So I wanted you to see that he is, you know, and again, when he bringeth in the firstborn into the world, he saith, and let all the angels of God worship him. That is glory right there. And of the angels, he saith, who maketh his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire. But unto the Son he saith, this is the Father speaking to the Son. But unto the Son he saith, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. So the Father is saying this. I mean, that is glorious. That shows their oneness. That shows that they're perfect unity, that they are one. And that is Jesus' goal in his high priestly prayer that we read, that we could share in his glory, that we could be with him where he is, that he would save us, that he would keep us from evil. I mean, he prays so many things in that prayer in John 17, that we'd be one with him, that we'd share in that glory. And in the Bible it says, my glory will I not give to another. But yet we get to share. What a privilege it is. So being that we get to share in his very glorious Shekinah glory, the Shekinah glory of God, we get to enter into that someday. The fact that he gives a little bit of a taste of that to our hearts on this earth, and the hope of that, the hope of heaven, the hope of being with him. And we are saved by hope too. The Bible does say we are saved by hope. And we're saved by grace too. We're saved by faith too. So we're saved by all of that. Faith, hope, grace, love, mercy. It's because of his mercies that we're not utterly consumed. Isn't that the truth? I know it is in my life. So we can see here how glorious this is, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person. And we get to share in that. So how does that help me? And let me tell you how that helps me in my prayer life, because God gives me such a position, an honor, to be able to someday look into his eyes, and he'll say to me, and these are the only words I want to hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of the Lord. That is the only thing that if I can hear that, that is what I live for, is to hear those words. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. Does that mean I'm going to be perfect from this point forward until I meet him? No. That means that he's going to be sanctifying me, the process of setting me apart, the process of transforming me until I become who he is. Love. He's love. God is love. And until people see that in me. And I hope you do. I hope you see that in me today. And I hope that you will pray with me today when I lead you in a prayer of salvation, because the most important thing that you can do in any aspect of your life is to give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. He loved you enough to die for you thousands of years ago, before you were even born. And he saw you in your mother's, in fact, he knit you together in your mother's womb. You're fearfully and wonderfully made. God does not make junk, okay? He makes beauty. And yes, because of sin, some people are born deformed and stuff like that. But even they can be healed. The power of God can heal them, and that's for his glory. All healing comes from God. I can tell you this, that anything that has anything to do with healing, God works through doctors too. Okay? He works through people like me, people on the street. Somebody may give you a kind word that you need, and it may touch you so deeply that you want more of that. And I can tell you, you can have all of that and then some if you come to Christ today. If you'll repent, the Bible says you must be born again. It says, except that a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. And that means born from above, born of his spirit, renewed, born in your heart. And you become a new person, and Christ dwells in you through faith, through the power of his word. So if that's you today, if you've never come to him, if you've never turned from your self-will, if you've never been willing to give up that part of you that has just been actually destroying you and making you miserable, because God created us with a hole in our heart, this shape, just like in the same shape of his love. And he created us that way so that we would need him, and we do need him. He's the sustainer of your life, and he wants to bless you. I'm not going to say you're going to have your best life now, because you may be going through a trial, and the trial may get tougher, but I'm here to say that he will get you through it. He will get you through it with people around you that will hold your hand through it, too. And here at One Current Crusades, we're here to do that. 1-855-70-JESUS. Call, leave a message. Call, leave a question. We're here for you to love you and answer any question. But have you answered this question? Whose are you? Do you know God? Do you know him and the power of his resurrection, that glorious power that raised him from the dead? Because if you don't, you won't be able to live with him where he is. What I was saying in there in John, what he's saying in John 17. But if you do, today is your day. If you feel that anything that the Holy Spirit has been tugging at your heart, if there's anything in you that says, hey, yeah, man, you know what? I filled myself up with drugs. I filled myself up with money and lust and to the maximum degree. And what has it gotten me? Well, it got Jeffrey Epstein a jail cell is what it got him. And then eventually he died. It got a lot of people mass graves. But I tell you what, today is your day. If you're here listening to me, today is your day. You can pray a prayer and God will begin. He will make you new. You'll be born again. That's what we're here for. That's why we have the power of the Holy Ghost. So I just speaking to you guys online because there's only two of us here. We're saved and we're serving. And that's where we want to get you, saved and serving, because there's no greater feeling than bringing people to the Lord, bringing people into the family of God, and seeing victories in people's life, seeing you delivered off drugs and alcohol, seeing you delivered from porn or nasty, or from idolatry, or from the love of money, or from self-aggrandizement, whatever it may be that is your idol, whatever is holding you, whatever it is that is not satisfying you, Jesus is your answer today. That's what he's saying for me to say to you, Jesus. It seems so simple, and it is simple. He doesn't make it complex for you. You come to him. Jesus said, he that comes to me, I will in no way cast out. He says, come to me as you are. But you're going to come to him, and he's not going to leave you where you're at. He loves you too much to leave you where you're at. He's going to take you from where you're at and set your feet upon a rock, so that you don't have worries anymore. He takes the cares of this world away from and gives us the spirit to care for other people who have the cares of this world, who are just eating them up, and we can see it. And all the stress that's going on in this world right now, and the pandemic, all this stuff that's happening around us, I have peace in my heart. I don't worry about tomorrow, know what's going to happen. What if this guy gets elected? Hey, when you got Jesus, these things just are like water off a duck's back. It doesn't faze you anymore. It doesn't faze you because you know where you're going. You know who you're serving. You know who created all this. You have the answers right here in your word. So if that's you today online, man, if you're just saying, Jeff, I'm miserable, hallelujah, praise God. Your answers, your breakthrough is coming, brother. Your breakthrough is coming, sister, that's on that dope out there right now. And you need to stop. You need to get off that Adderall and that whatever it is that's just keeping you in bondage. You need to get off of it, and God is going to get you off of it today. That's his plan. And you may not quit today, but he's going to give you the road to get off of. He's going to give you the people. He's going to put people in your life. You have to make this decision, though. You're responsible to make a decision. You're accountable to God, though you don't know it. But he will take all of your account and wipe it clean. That's what he does. So that you can have that peace in your heart and a clean conscience before him. That's where what our goal is for you today, is to get the Spirit of God in you, to get Jesus being formed in you, so that you can love on others and be a part of the solution, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. So if that's you, man, and you're saying, Jeff, I just don't know. I've done. No, you haven't done too much. There's nothing that you can do. Nothing can separate you from the love of God. If you're his, he's going to get you. And so you might as well make it right now. So if that's you, man, we're right where you're at, just raise your hand with me. I'm going to make it easy for you. Even though I'm already saved, I'm going to raise my hand with you, and I'm going to pray with you. And I'm going to pray for you after that, that you'll be blessed and prospered in every way, especially in your faith, that you're going to get today. So if that's you, raise your hand. You know, and I don't know where you're at. You may be in a group of people. Hopefully you're, you know, socially distancing and being obedient. If not, okay. But let's pray this prayer together, because he loves you so much that he went to the cross, died for you to settle your sin and wipe all that, wipe your slate clean, so that you can feel that cleanliness inside you. You know it's real, it's supernatural. So I pray, I'm gonna pray for you right now, and I'm gonna pray with you. Let's pray this prayer together. If that's you, if you're saying, I'm not saved, or maybe you slipped away from him and you're miserable. I've done that too. And I tell you, I was more miserable than any person on this earth. And I made other people's lives miserable, especially my parents, who saw me going down the path again and again. They're like, oh boy, doesn't have to be you anymore. You can be the lifter up of your family's head now, because God will be the lifter up of your head now. So if that's you, raise your hand with me, and just with all eyes closed, with all heads bowed, just please pray this prayer with me to get to know the Father and Jesus Christ, whom he has sent for you, because he loves you. So pray this prayer with me. Father,
Father,
I admit I'm a sinner. And I need you, Jesus. Please save me today.
I repent.
I turn from all the evil I know I'm doing.
And I turn to you.
I receive you into my heart right now, Jesus.
And I thank you that I have eternal life.
I now consider myself saved. And I thank you so much. Amen. God bless you guys. And if you prayed that prayer with me, I want to pray a prayer with you. I want to pray a prayer for you and over you and over your family right now, and just as the Lord leads. So, Father, I pray for all those that prayed with me right now, that you would bless them, that you would touch them, that you would cleanse them, that you would take out of their lives that which is contrary to your purpose, Lord, and put into their lives that which is going to bring them peace. Lord, bless them. Prosper them. Make your face to shine upon them, Lord.
Amen.
Lead them in the way everlasting, Father. Show them your glory and greatness while they're here on this earth, Lord. Give them a miracle today, Lord. Your hand isn't shortened that it can't be saved, that you cannot save anymore. And Lord, you are chock full of miracles still happening. So I pray that you work miracles over their lives, Lord, and over their siblings' lives, Lord, over their families and friends' lives, Lord. Let them be a light that will so shine that they will attract others to you, Lord, into the kingdom by the light that they're shining and by the love that they're showing and by the kind words that they're saying, Father. I pray that you put it into all of them that prayed and those that didn't, that you would convict them, Lord, with heavy conviction from your Holy Ghost. Sweetly break them, Lord, and then put them back together for your glory. God, I pray these things in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you guys. We love you. This is the time where we usually, what do we usually do? We do a raffle, but we don't have that, and we're not at the park, so
Amen.
We're not feeding right now. But
so we're going to go through the Our Father.
Yeah.
Before that, tomorrow we're going to be celebrating Memorial Day, and I didn't put it in earlier in the service or put it in the music, but God has everything under control, and we just bless all the military and people associated with the military that even goes to the development of our weapons. And manufacturing so that we could have our freedom. We salute them. Pastor Scott texted me, we salute you. So we're saluting them. I'm saluting my daughter, U.S. Army Cav Scout, 10th company, her husband, infantry, my father, Coast Guard, my uncle, Navy, my cousin, Navy Air Pilot, my nephew, Navy, my husband, Marine, my handyman, U.S. Army, 27 years. We pray that any junk that they brought back with them that has stopped them from coming to Christ and trying to kill their pain, and that they're homeless and they have no place to go. I pray that they would go to the footsteps of Jesus, and that the Lord would just bless them and adopt them, and that they know that they're loved by the power of the Holy Spirit. At the end of a day, they come and they do taps. So I'm going to do taps here. Children that have gone before us to serve as the reception line in heaven's gates. We salute you in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
So now is our time where we circle up usually or huddle up in prayer. We do the Our Father. We do it the King James way, Matthew 6:9,
yep.
In earth and the debtors, like a wedding ring, the eternity. Circle that goes on forever. We have each other's back through prayer. We have each other's back by esteeming our brother or sister more than ourselves.
Yeah.
We remain humble.
Yeah.
We come against that spirit of pride and that that type A control of know-it-alls. Because only Jesus knows.
Amen.
It's for us to submit to His will, to be the one in control and not of ourselves. Lest anyone should boast.
Amen.
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 So we're going to say, who is Father?
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debtors as we forget our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. Forever and ever. Amen.
Prayers
go up, blessings come down. Prayers go up, blessings come down. Prayers go up, blessings come down. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. We hope you enjoyed service today and got a whole lot out. Amen. You have a blessing.